أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Okay, so far we discussed about acute inflammation, their vascular change and the cellular change. So we took an example of oral mucosa, and if any bacteria or any infection enters the oral mucosa, what happens? There is a blood vessel and the signal comes from the immune cells to the endothelium, and endothelium release what?
Histamine.
Histamine goes and acts on the smooth muscle cells, right? Immediately the vessel will go for
vasodilation.
When the vasodilation happens, what happens? More blood flow, more blood enters, that increase the pressure and the fluid goes out. Yeah. Once the fluid only going out, that fluid is called transudate. That fluid is called transudate. Okay. What?
In the
capillaries. Yeah.
The gob is also there's gob.
Yeah. Yeah, that's why then normally the fluid goes out and comes back. Okay, that is called fluid dynamics. That inshallah I'll discuss in the hemodynamics after. Okay, I told you normal fluid exchange, right? That happens with the normal endothelial gap. So there is a pressure in the normal pressure that sends the fluid out, and the pressure goes down, the fluid comes back. Okay, that is a normal fluid exchange that we'll discuss more in the hemodynamic disorder. So now you concentrate, there is more blood is coming, that will increase the hydrostatic pressure, then the fluid starts going out, more fluid goes out to the interstitium, and that is called transudate, that is called transudation, after that the protein escapes, the protein goes out. Once the protein and the fluid both mixed up, then that is called exudate. So this is called exudation. So once the fluid goes out, protein goes out, the flow, laminar flow is altered. The neutrophil goes to the endothelium and it escapes out. So now we got neutrophil, proteins and fluid, and they all go to the bacteria or any infected organism is there, then they will kill them and they also die. They form the pus. The pus just comes out, right? So this is what we discussed so far, right? Now one chemical substance you guys know, that is histamine, right? You know one chemical substance, that is histamine. Now let us discuss now. You know the neutrophil comes out, right? Now we have a bacteria, right? And the neutrophil comes out, and the neutrophil goes to the bacteria and they take the bacteria inside, right? That is phagocytosis. Now when the neutrophil takes the bacteria, okay, so this neutrophil is activated. Okay, this is called activated neutrophil. They are ready to kill. Okay, activated neutrophil. Now there are many things happens inside the neutrophil. I'm going to explain only one mechanism, because where our painkillers, anti fever drugs act. Okay, so now let us draw the neutrophil in big size. Okay, this is neutrophil. Okay, this is the nucleus of the neutrophil. It is a bilobed it has lobes, right? It is a nucleus of the neutrophil. And when there is activation in the neutrophil, you know the cell membrane of the neutrophil is made up of phospholipid. Now there is a enduring inflammation, enduring activation, enduring trigger of inflammation. The enzyme which is activated is phospholipase A2 is the enzyme which is activated. Okay, it is activated by a two chemical substance. You should memorize it. That is TNF and interleukin 1. Okay, TNF means tumor. It's a chemical substance. Tumor necrosis factor. Okay, and interleukin 1. It's very, very important. And because of these substances, because of these substances, they trigger the neutrophil to activate the phospholipase A2. Then the phospholipase is an enzyme which goes to the phospholipid and they break the phospholipid. They break down the phospholipid and they form a acid called arachidonic acid. Understand? So this substance is formed. Once this substance is formed, again because of this TNF and IL-1, there is another enzyme which is activated, that is called cyclooxygenase enzyme. This cyclooxygenase is commonly called as COX. Okay, so this cyclooxygenase enzyme is activated. This enzyme will go to the arachidonic acid and break the arachidonic acid, and they form many chemical substances. I am going to discuss only one chemical substance, that is called prostaglandin. There are many types of prostaglandin. If you know as a general, that is enough. They break down the arachidonic acid and they form a chemical substance that is called prostaglandin. Very, very important. This is the substance which goes out of the neutrophil, goes into the blood and goes to the brain. In the brain we have hypothalamus. You all know hypothalamus? It goes to the hypothalamus and it increases the body temperature. That results as fever. And they are also responsible for pain. So when we don't want fever, when we want to stop the fever, when we want to reduce the fever, so we have to stop this enzyme. We have to block this enzyme, so prostaglandin is not formed. You understand? The prostaglandin is not formed. So we give you a drug which blocks this enzyme. They are called COX inhibitors. Cyclooxygenase inhibitors. You know paracetamol? They all do this function. Paracetamol, all commonly used painkillers, anti-fever drugs. Okay, Brufen, Ibugesic, many drugs. Okay, paracetamol, Prozin, Panadol, all comes as a acetaminophen. Okay, they all block this cyclooxygenase, and what happens? The prostaglandin is not formed, then fever and pain reduces. Fever and pain reduces. So this is called arachidonic acid metabolism. This is called arachidonic acid metabolism. Now you all understand this? Yes or no? Okay, I'll tell once again. Whenever I am telling one, repeating the things, I will add something. Okay, now you guys interact. Now there is oral mucosa, some bacteria entered. Okay, what happens? Come on, there is blood vessel, we have immune cells, macrophage or mast cell, something gives the information to the. You guys are feeling hungry? Come on guys, talk, interact. What happens? They trigger the endothelial cells and secrete what?
Histamine.
Then histamine? Smooth muscle cells. Then smooth muscle cells causes vasodilation. Now more blood enters. Then pressure increases. Now we all have gaps, endothelial gaps. The fluid goes out. Okay? If fluid only goes out, it is transudate. It is transudate. The process is called transudation. Understand? Then after a period of time, the protein goes out. It is called exudate. It is called exudation. It is called exudation. Now the laminar flow is altered. So the neutrophil comes to the contact with the endothelium. Okay? So the fluid is like a hijab for neutrophil. Okay, if hijab is removed, then the neutrophil goes on contact with the endothelium. Then the neutrophil goes out. The neutrophil goes out and all surrounds the bacteria and they destroy the bacteria and they pass a pus, right? So before that, they need to tell our brain something is happening, right? So for that, the neutrophil membrane made up of phospholipid. So there is a chemical substances released during acute inflammation is TNF and IL-1 that is increased in acute inflammation. Then this will stimulate the neutrophil and activate the phospholipase A2. Then what it does? They break the phospholipid and they form arachidonic acid. They form arachidonic acid. Then there is another enzyme which is activated, that is cyclooxygenase enzyme. Okay, then that will break the arachidonic acid and they form prostaglandin. The prostaglandin goes to the brain and they cause hypothalamus and they increase the body temperature and results in fever and pain. You all understand this? So we give you a drugs to block this. So fever and pain gets reduced. Understand? So they are called COX inhibitors. They are called COX inhibitors. Okay. Now you all understand this, right? Okay. Now you know stomach, right? Stomach secretes what? Acid or what? It secretes HCl. Very concentrated HCl. Very strong acid. See, if acid comes out, stomach wall can be destroyed, right? So stomach wall is protected from acid, right?
Yes.
How, what is the substance which protects the stomach wall from acid? What substance? Who took G8 physiology? Dr. Matthews? Okay. So now it is covered by mucus, right? The stomach wall is covered by a special thick substance called mucus. Understand? This mucus, actually Professor Mathi is my was my teacher when I was studying MBBS. He was a very strict man. MashaAllah. Very good man actually. You know, coming to the point. And where we are, brothers? Okay, acid is secreted by the stomach cells and then it is also, the cells also secrete gastric mucosa also secrete mucus. So it coats the stomach wall. So acid only digests the food, not the stomach wall. Understand? Acid only breaks down the food. Stomach wall is protected by the mucus. Understand? Subhanallah, it's Allah's creation, brothers. If we would have created, we would have done the reverse. Okay, so now coming to the mucus. This mucus, for the production of mucus, we need prostaglandin. Type, which means we need cyclooxygenase here. To produce mucosal prostaglandin, to produce mucus. You all understand this phrase? We need cyclooxygenase in the stomach to produce mucosal prostaglandin, to produce mucus. Okay, it's clear? Yes. See, this is the prostaglandin. That's why I'm using the word mucosal prostaglandin. Okay, their purpose is to produce mucus. Understand? So, there the cells are different. It's not a neutrophil. Understand? The cell is a stomach cell. Understand? Stomach epithelium, gastric epithelium. Understand? They secrete mucus. Now, if you block cyclooxygenase here, you are giving paracetamol and blocking cyclooxygenase. But the paracetamol block cyclooxygenase here also. Understand? So, prostaglandin is stopped here. Meanwhile, the mucosal prostaglandin is also stopped here. Here the function of prostaglandin is, here the function is pain and fever. That is stopped or reduced. Here the function of prostaglandin is to produce mucus. What will happen to the mucus? Mucus will be reduced. Acid mucus balance is lost. So what will happen? That will damage the stomach wall. That will produce ulcer of the stomach. That will produce inflammation in the stomach. That will produce gastritis. That will produce gastric ulcer. So that's why when you give the painkiller, they get severe stomachache. So that's why we give the painkiller along with a drug which reduces the acid secretion. So both will be balanced. You understand? So when you give cyclooxygenase inhibitor, for example, brothers, a person comes with some abscess in the gum, okay, periodontal abscess, and you are giving painkiller and antibiotic, antibacterial, and you forgot to give the anti-acid drug, and the patient calls you after 3 days, doctor, actually I'm getting severe stomach pain, okay, and immediately you should realize that you forgot or the patient has not taken the anti-acid, okay, immediately you have to tell the patient to stop the painkiller and you have to give the anti-acid drug so the mucosa comes back and the ulcer formed in the stomach heals. Understand? So this is very, very clinical significance. Sometimes a patient already have a gastric ulcer problem. Okay, if you have a gastric ulcer problem, you are giving painkiller, it will damage more. Understand? So this is the importance of knowing the arachidonic acid metabolism. Okay, now there are some drugs which can block the phospholipase A2. The whole inflammation shutdown. So, you know steroids? Steroids block the phospholipase A2. It shut down the complete inflammation. But very rarely we use steroids. Okay, now let us summarize. Okay, let us start from the beginning. This is the oral mucosa. Now the bacteria comes. What happens? The immune cells send signal to the endothelium. Then endothelium releases histamine. Histamine acts on the smooth muscle cells. And what happens to the blood vessel? Vasodilation. and more blood is coming, the more pressure. Okay, and histamine not only does vasodilation, it also communicate with endothelial cells to give more gap. Okay, because I'm telling a little bit more here, endothelial cells also has some actin filaments. Okay, the histamine sits on the endothelial cells and the endothelial cells constrict. Okay, so they give more gap. So what happens, more fluid goes out. Only fluid going, it is called transudation. Now the protein also goes out, that is called exudate. Then the laminar flow is altered. What happens, neutrophil comes out and they all kill the bacteria and they die and they form the pus. So during this process, TNF and IL-1 is increased, that will go to the neutrophil and break the phospholipid to arachidonic acid. The phospholipase A2 enzyme does that. Yeah,
this process happens before killing the bacteria.
Yeah, during that process. Okay, so then during that process it happens. Okay, so now then cyclooxygenase enzymes break the arachidonic acid and produce prostaglandin. Then the prostaglandin goes to the brain and cause hypothalamus, cause pain and fever. Okay, now we have a drug to block cyclooxygenase, right? And what happened, they block the mucosa of the stomach and they produce gastritis Now they found a research that there are two types of cyclooxygenase, COX-1 and COX-2. So COX-1 is responsible for production of mucus. Okay, and if they produce COX-2 inhibitor, so the mucus is not blocked. Understand? So they found COX-2 inhibitor. If you give COX-2 inhibitor, there is no gastritis. But COX-2 inhibitor will produce, you know, heart blood vessel supplied. You know what is the blood vessel supplies the heart? What is the name of the blood vessel? Coronary arteries. This COX-2 inhibitor blocks the coronary arteries. So the patient will get heart attack. So it is more dangerous. Understand? So that's why COX-2 inhibitor, you should not give it for old age people. In India and all, it is banned. I don't know about Saudi. In India, it is banned. In UK, it is banned. So in US, it is allowed. But actually, they carefully give, depends upon the age. You cannot give for the old people or heart disease patient. Okay. So you all understand this mechanism. So I'll be asking cases in and around this. Okay. So if you are not understanding, see the video once again, you will understand definitely. Okay. If you have any doubt. So let us go to the slides. Okay. So acute inflammation has two major components in the mechanism. One is vascular change, other one is cellular event. Vascular change, it happens due to histamine. You guys all know it increases the blood flow due to vasodilation, and they also bring some structural change. That is, I told, no, endothelial cells will give more gap. That is called increased vascular permeability. Now they allow the plasma proteins to leave the circulation. They enter the tissue space. Now cellular events happen. That is, immigration means migration of leukocytes from the circulation to the tissue space. So then the leukocytes accumulate in the area of injury. The leukocyte goes to the area of injury. The most common leukocyte involved in acute inflammation are neutrophil. Other name for neutrophil is polymorphonuclear leukocytes. Okay, this is what happened. This is the normal vasculature. You can see the arteriole, you can see the venule, these are the capillaries. So what happens once there is inflammation? See, there is vasodilation. So more blood comes, so the fluid escapes out and the neutrophils comes out. neutrophils comes out. Okay, see, this is neutrophil, they are lymphocytes, they are lymphocytes, understand? So mononuclear cells. So more neutrophils comes out, more neutrophils comes out. So vascular permeability, see, that's what he was asking, that in normal gap, normal endothelial gap, with normal pressure the fluid goes out, because of colloidal osmotic pressure the fluid comes inside. Don't worry about this pressure, inshallah I'll be discussing in the hemodynamic disorder, you will become master in it. Okay, pressure and all, I'll make it very easy to understand. Okay, so now you understand, normally the fluid goes out, comes in. Okay, now if you understand that, that is enough. What happens if there is vasodilation, then the more fluid goes out, less fluid comes in. Okay, more fluid goes out, less fluid comes in, so that leads to the fluid leakage. Only the fluid is going out, it is called transudate. If the plasma proteins also leaks out, then it is called exudate. So exudate most commonly happens in infections, most commonly happens in infectious conditions. Okay, now what happens after that? The neutrophil attached to the endothelium, it slowly moves down and it comes out and it kills the bacteria, okay, or any infected substances. Okay, so now in the, see, this is about acute inflammation. Okay, now concentrate here. If any infection or any infarction means necrosis, or any toxin, any trauma comes, acute inflammation is stimulated. So there is vasodilation, and then all the fluid goes out, protein goes out, neutrophil goes out, and they, what they do, they kill the bacteria and they form the pus. So the definition of pus is, there is necrotic cellular debris. Debris means waste, cellular waste material, and it may contain infected organism, it may contain bacteria or it may not contain bacteria, and they have degenerated. Degenerate means dead neutrophil. So this all combination is called pus. It is yellow, murky, very bad, foul smell fluid. Okay, so it is a gross definition of pus. Okay, now how it happens? Through chemical substances released during inflammation. So these chemical substances may be produced by the cells, some are present in the plasma. So it is produced by the cell, it is called cell derived mediators. If it present by in the plasma, it is called plasma derived mediators. Okay, example for cell derived mediators, histamine comes from the mast cells. If anything is synthesized new, example prostaglandin and cytokines, it is synthesized during inflammation. But histamine is stored, already produced, and it is stored. Understand? So this is the difference between histamine and the other chemical substances. Okay, now let us discuss about histamine. Histamine is otherwise called as VAS, comes under the group of chemical substances called vasoactive amines. Vasoactive means they act on the blood vessels and they produce vasodilation. Okay, the same kind of chemical substance which present in the platelet, that is called serotonin. What they do, they produce dilation of the blood vessels, arteriolar dilation, and they increase the vascular permeability. And histamine, after they finish the function, it is inactivated by an enzyme called histaminase. Now coming to the cell derived mediators, again it is called arachidonic acid metabolites. The products comes out of arachidonic acid. Okay, during the inflammation, what happens? This phospholipases are produced or gets activated, and they break the phospholipid and they form arachidonic acid. That is the most commonly seen in the inflammation. Or it can come, arachidonic acid can come from the diet, from the linoleic acid. Okay, but this is the pathway very important. okay, from phospholipid getting breakdown by a enzyme phospholipase, and they produce phospholipid. Okay, now there are two pathways involved in arachidonic acid breakdown. Only one pathway I discussed, that is cyclooxygenase pathway. Okay, if you know, it's enough. Cyclooxygenase pathway produce what? Prostaglandin. Okay, there are different types of prostaglandin, but if you know, remember as a prostaglandin, that is enough. The prostaglandin is responsible for pain and fever in inflammation. Okay, now let us discuss about how the drugs interact. You know, aspirin and another group of drugs called non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, that ibuprofen, paracetamol, all comes under that. They inhibit the cyclooxygenase activity and prostaglandin synthesis. So they are used in treatment of pain and fever. There are two forms of cyclooxygenase. Cyclooxygenase 1 and cyclooxygenase 2. Cyclooxygenase 1 is expressed in the gastric mucosa. It is needed for production of mucosal prostaglandin, and in turn they produce mucus, which protects the stomach wall against acid induced damage. This you all know, right? So if you give aspirin and NSAID, that inhibits both cyclooxygenase 1 and 2. Okay, so that will produce gastritis and gastric ulceration. But COX-2 inhibitors are now available, but they produce coronary artery disease. They produce coronary artery disease because they produce this chemical substance, TXA2, that is called thromboxane. If you know coronary artery disease, for dental students, is enough. If you give COX-2 inhibitor, they produce coronary artery disease. So there is another powerful anti-inflammatory agent that is called corticosteroid, which blocks the phospholipase A2, and complete inhibition of the arachidonic acid metabolites happens. So forget about everything, just concentrate on the things which I am telling. This is a phospholipid seen in the cell membrane. Phospholipase break and form the arachidonic acid, and cyclooxygenase breaks it and forms the prostaglandin. So when you know this produces pain and fever, if you want to block, you want to reduce the pain and fever, we have to block the cyclooxygenase. So we use COX-1 and COX-2 inhibitor. Here I discussed about benefit of COX-1 and COX-2. Okay, you should know about this. And if you use steroid, it will block the phospholipase. See, the whole mechanism is shut down. So the complete inflammation is shut down. It is not good for the person. Okay, so we use steroid in some diseases, not in all the diseases. And very rarely we use steroid. So what are the other chemical substances involved in acute inflammation? And this is very, very important one. TNF and IL-1 is involved in acute inflammation, and it is the one stimulates the neutrophil to produce prostaglandin. Understand? So it's very, very important. And interferon gamma and IL-12 is involved in chronic inflammation, that I will discuss more in chronic inflammation. So now other chemical substance called chemokines, that also involved, that produce more leukocyte into the site of inflammation. And another chemical substance is called reactive oxygen species, that are produced within the lysosomes, that kills the microbes. And there is another chemical substance called neuropeptide P, that produce pain signal, that also stimulate pain. And there is another substance, nitric oxide, that also kills microbes. There are three chemical substances that directly kills the microbes. One is reactive oxygen species, other one is nitric oxide, other one is activated complement that forms a membrane attack complex, and they put hole in the bacteria, and they make the bacteria to bust. So that is called membrane attack complex, which is formed by the complement proteins. These proteins are present in the plasma, normally in inactive stage. During inflammation, they become active. During inflammation, they become active. So these are the various chemical substances involved in chemical in the acute inflammation. Okay. So this slide is not needed. So this ends the acute inflammation chapter.